Hello and welcome to today's presentation about semi-supervised clustering via Markov aggregation. My name is Sophie Steger and I have the honor to present to you the shortened paper of my colleagues Bernard Geiger, Marek Smeyer and I. You can find the link to our full paper and to the corresponding Python code at the end of the slides. First, I'll give a very quick introduction about clustering in general. Then I'll briefly cover the theory behind unsupervised clustering via Markov aggregation and our contribution in form of additional pairwise constraints. Then we'll have a look at how our semi-supervised algorithm performs in experiments compared to other state-of-the-art clustering algorithms. Lastly, I'll talk about limitations and benefits of our contribution. Unsupervised clustering. Given is a set of unlabeled data points. The aim is to group those data points based on some similarity measure. Semi-supervised clustering. If available, we can use prior information to improve clustering accuracy, either in the form of partition-level site information, where we know the class label of a subset of data points, or in the form of instance-level site information, where we know if a pair of data points has the same class label, must link constraints, or different class labels, cannot link constraints. Next, we'll talk about the theory behind semi-supervised clustering via Markov aggregation. Markov aggregation. Given is a Markov chain X on the alphabet curly X. The aim is to find a Markov chain Y on the alphabet curly Y that best approximates X on a smaller alphabet. How is this done? By mapping X onto Y via the deterministic mapping G. The mapping G should achieve that the hidden Markov process Y is Markov and preserves the temporal dependence structure of X. This mapping is determined by minimizing the following cost function, cited below. The first two terms consisting of conditional entropies are concerned with keeping the Markov property. The third term captures the goal of preserving the temporal dependence structure of X. This framework covers some special cases. For beta equal to 0.5, the information-theoretic pairwise clustering, and for beta equal to 1, the information bottleneck problem. Now the question arises how this can be used for clustering tasks. The idea is the following. By minimizing the previous cost function, we achieve a grouping of states of X. This is now used for the grouping of data points. How? By first constructing the probability matrix P, where xi, xj are the coordinates of the ith and jth data points. Then we take the squared Euclidean distance between them, scaled by sigma k. In this work, sigma k was chosen as the k nearest neighbor distance. So we see that the algorithm has two hyperparameters that can be tuned, beta and k. Now that the core theory is covered, I will demonstrate our algorithm in the form of a simple example. Given are several data points, xi, that are displayed as nodes in a graph. Connections between nodes are given by cannot link constraints. Must link constraints are displayed by a dotted ellipse. Each of the data points belongs to one of three classes. This is shown by the color of the corresponding node, here yellow, green and blue. In the beginning, the graph has to be initialized. A random coloring is not sufficient as we want to ensure that the pairwise constraints are fulfilled. This is solved by a greedy coloring algorithm. Each constraint node is assigned to the first color available. Unconstrained nodes are randomly colored. Now we start with the sequential Markov aggregation algorithm. Nodes connected by must-link constraints are treated jointly. The nodes are assigned to the first class y1, while the rest of the nodes keep their color. Then the cost for this graph coloring is computed and stored. Afterwards, the node is assigned to the next class label. However, due to the cannot link constraint, y2 is not allowed and skipped. The last class label is allowed and the cost is computed. Then, in the last step, the node is assigned to the class label that achieved the lowest cost. In this case, the blue class y3. The same procedure is repeated for the rest of the nodes. Finally, we have a look at some experimental results of our semi-supervised clustering algorithm. First, I'll quickly present the experimental setup. In order to measure the accuracy of the clustering results, we use the normalized mutual information that is defined as such, where curly X is the true partition and curly Y the estimated partition. A value of 0 indicates no mutual information, a value of 1 indicates identical partitions. The pairwise constraints are generated from labeling a fraction of data points. We average the results for 10 different runs. In this synthetic example, consisting of 3 concentric circles, we see the clustering result for the unsupervised algorithm that does not lead to the correct partitioning. However, when adding a few pairwise constraints as indicated in the figure, the results are indeed correct. The unsupervised Markov aggregation algorithm is highly sensitive to the choice of its hyperparameters beta and k. Naturally, it was a goal to investigate how the pairwise constraints affect the sensitivity to the hyperparameters. First, we analyzed the influence of the parameter k for different values of beta and a different fraction of labeled data points on the datasets circles and iris. Ideally, k is chosen such that the transition probability matrix is nearly completely decomposable. The aim is to observe the influence on accuracy for the unsupervised and semi-supervised case. Here we see the results on the circles dataset, beta equal to 0, 0.5, and 1. On the one hand, we observe the drop in accuracy for small values of beta. On the other hand, the results show that the clustering performance is more robust the more pairwise constraints we include. The same is repeated for the iris dataset. Here, the NMI shows less variations with respect to changes in k. However, pairwise constraints also lead to an increase in accuracy. For all further experiments, k was fixed as 20. Here, the accuracy for both circles and iris showed a stable performance. Next, the influence of the parameter beta. K is equal to 20 and beta is varied for 7 selected UCI datasets. Again, we compare the accuracy for the un- and semi-supervised case. The blue line corresponds to the accuracy for the unsupervised case, whereas for the orange line a fraction of 20% of data was labeled. For small values of beta, the algorithm is stuck in bad local minima that cannot be escaped by introducing pairwise constraints. This is why an annealing scheme was introduced, which is further described in our full-length paper on archive if anyone is interested. For most datasets, the site information successfully increases the clustering accuracy. Next, we look at the performance of our algorithm compared to state-of-the-art clustering algorithms for different fractions of labeled data points. Beta is fixed as 0.5 and k as 20. In this experiment, we are interested in the influence of the labeled data on accuracy compared to other methods. Here, you can pause the video to look at the results for all datasets. Overall, our CoMaC algorithm clearly benefits from pairwise constraints and can compete with the other algorithms. On the iris dataset, only 20% of labeled data points noticeably improve the accuracy of CoMaC, while the other techniques do not benefit as much from additional site information. Also, on the GLAS dataset, the increased accuracy is obvious. On the E. coli dataset, the performance is not superior, but again, the accuracy increases a lot for more pairwise constraints. Lastly, we repeat this experiment. Now, the site information only covers two classes. The two classes are selected randomly and must cover at least 30% of the total data. Again, we look at the influence of labeled data on accuracy. The results show that CoMaC is very robust against missing labels from other classes. Here are the details for the same datasets as in the experiment before. Across the board, CoMaC performs really well and is able to use the partial site information to increase accuracy. Limitations. After seeing that CoMaC can compete with state-of-the-art clustering algorithms in those two experiments, we still have to talk about some limitations. Erroneous partition-level site information. Our algorithm is highly sensitive to noisy constraints. When the pairwise constraints are not exhaustive, we need to propagate them to possibly increase accuracy. Lastly, cannot link constraints can have negative influence for datasets with few classes and for moderate numbers of cannot link constraints. In the initial coloring, the nodes connected by cannot link constraints are assigned to the first cluster available. For example, for two classes, the problem is that in the sequential algorithm, after the greedy coloring, the constrained data pairs are forced to stay in place as no free class is available. A detailed discussion of all points mentioned here can be found in our full-length paper. Summing up some points of this presentation. We extended the unsupervised clustering algorithm via Markov aggregation such that it can accept pairwise constraints. The pairwise constraints lower the sensitivity to hyperparameter changes. CoMaC can learn nonlinear decision boundaries and competes with state-of-the-art semi-supervised clustering algorithms. Here are the links to our full paper on archive and to my GitHub repository containing the code and data for the experiments. Thank you for your attention.